And welcome to another edition of Mark's Madness. It's a special edition of Mark's Madness, joined as always by Mark Miller. I'm Matt Finkel, and Mark, it's the end of the football season.
Yeah.
It's also the beginning of the basketball season. I know you're getting excited to call some basketball games. So what we're going to do today is we're going to talk state finals football, and then we'll be joined by Mark Schein later on to preview the start of the boys' basketball season. So a lot to look forward to. Yeah. Let's jump right in, though. Division 4, Kenton. Yeah. Falls in a tight one. Their season ends in the state semis for the second straight year, but a lot to be proud of for this Wildcats group.
Oh, a lot. You know, they started off, we've chronicled it through the season, 0-2, ran off 11 straight wins. Lots of change over there in Kenton. They righted that ship. Brent Fackler did a great job, coach of the year, in a lot of different minds, that's for sure. And they lost to a very, very good team. Kettering Alder is really good. And they played them, and they were ahead of them, and they could have won that game. Not that they should have. They didn't blow it or anything, but they lost to a quality opponent. And but a great year for Kenton. You know, you win 11 games, that's a heck of a year.
In that game, Kenton actually led at the end of the third, 14-10, and a lot of scoring in the fourth. And that Alter got two touchdowns late. That Kenton defense has been a strength of the team all season long. And not to say it failed them at the end, but shutting down that Alter offense for the first three quarters was challenging enough. Yeah. And then Alter kind of got to where they normally go in the fourth.
Like a lot of great teams in Alter is, they eventually found a way. And that defense did carry Kenton while the offense was growing up. And they grew up and they ended up being really, really good. But, yeah, credit that defense. I never apologize for my voice. I got this Wolfman Jack thing going on.
I think it's very distinguished.
You're too young to understand who Wolfman
Jack
is.
I know who Wolfman Jack is,
yes. Okay. Yeah.
But very distinguished. Yeah. I like his deep voice today. Yeah. I think it adds, it's, you know, state finals, so we got to really sound like we know what we're talking about.
Right? Yeah.
All right.
But good job to Kenton.
Great job for Kenton. And they'll be back in it next year, I'm sure. Trent Heights was just a sophomore. They are losing a handful of seniors, as every program does, you know, this time of year, and it's all about rebuilding, and they've got the foundation laid there with Brent Fackler. So let's turn our attention now to Division 5 in Coldwater, and they're back to the state finals for the sixth straight year.
Isn't that hard to believe?
How many games is that?
90.
They'll play 90
90. I can remember when that freshman class grew up and they were going to their fourth, and the theme down there was play 60. They wanted to play 60 games, 15 games for 4 years, and those freshmen, sophomore, junior, senior, that class did. Well, since then, they've gone to 95. Now they're at 90, 6 years in a row. That's unbelievable.
Unbelievable. Yeah. And a 34-3 victory over Cincinnati Hills Christian Academy in a game that the defense just continues to do what it does. And Brody Hoyne scored four total touchdowns. And the script is kind of the same week after week. This team just wins in dominant fashion.
Yeah, they do. They don't make a lot of mistakes. Brody's healthy. They rely on him heavily. But they got a lot of other players that if you're going to take one guy away, they've got some other guys that can come in and do it. We saw that when he got hurt in the middle of the season. They came in and they threw it and they kept winning. So they've got some good players on both sides of the ball. Their special teams is really solid. Now they're going to play Canton Central Catholic. That's my old stomping grounds. And I know who they play. They play a good schedule. They play some bigger schools. They play some of the Federal League teams, which is the league I grew up in. That Federal League was a little weaker this year than normal. How does that compare with the MAC? Well, we all know the MAC is great competition week in and week out. So I don't think Coldwater's giving away anything to Central Catholic on the strength of schedule. This should be a good game. 14-0, 13-1. The one for Coldwater was Marion Local. They might be in a class of their own. But, yeah, this should be a good game for Coldwater.
Really looking forward to this one. Yeah. This is definitely going to be a good one. At the Shoe, that's exciting because when you go there six straight years, now you play in a different venue for the first year, and it happens to be the Ohio Stadium.
So Coldwater loses that we've been here before kind of thing, although they've
that's
been in big
point.
Games.
Yeah.
But they've been a different venue, as you say. But Canton Central Catholic loses that, hey, we're going to play in the stadium 5 minutes down the road.
Right.
Now they're going to get in the car and drive 2 hours, maybe lose some of that hometown advantage that they would have. So it's a toss-up, two good teams. But if you've been there 6 years in a row, they're not going to show you anything you haven't seen.
Common opponent for them, Bishop Hartley.
Uh-huh.
Both teams defeated Bishop Hartley, Coldwater by 12, I believe it was, back in week two, and Canton by 10.
34-24
in the postseason last week.
So, so very even there, too.
So we should expect a good game there.
Yeah.
Division 6 are, now I don't want to call them a Cinderella, but Garen Stokes, their head coach, might call them a Cinderella, but Minster is going to the state finals for the first time since they won it all in 1989, 25 years, and what a game against Tenora. This was a fantastic game all around.
You know, Eli Wolf blocks a punt, Josh Nixon gets a two-yard run, and then the extra point by Jason Schultz to win it, 14-13. How do you get a closer game than that to get to the state finals? Tenora, congratulations to them, 13-1, an excellent team. You know, so Minster has beaten all comers. Now they're up against Kirtland. They've been in the state championship the last 3 years. They won it last year, runner-up the year before. Who beat them? Coldwater, 10-9.
That's their only loss, actually, since the start of the 2011 season.
There you go. So that's an excellent program, but I wouldn't bet against Minster. You know, they got it rolling right now. When you get a group of guys believing in each other, like Coach says, you know, you can do great things.
I think that's exactly what happened for them, and Coach will be the first to tell you, they were maybe soft and selfish. That's what he said following the game earlier in the year. They've all come together believing in their common goal, and they're playing their best football. You and I were talking, they're actually pretty young. Yeah. You know, they don't have a ton of seniors on the roster, but these guys have they're playing like seniors, and they're playing experienced. And to get that victory, a missed field goal by Tenora, and, you know, credit the Rams. They got down the field and got in position to win that game, and we all know how difficult kicking is, especially at the high school level, and Minster comes out on top.
Great win for them, and now it's time to go get another one since 89. They're looking to hang that second banner up there.
Absolutely. That'll be played Friday at Ohio Stadium, 3 p.m. We'll have highlights for you on the Sports Report. Division 7 now.
Yep.
Marion Local, they're back. They're seeking back. Their fourth straight state title.
Yeah.
And just the MAC, you know, three in a row, three teams in a row. Division 5, 6, and 7, they're there.
Started off with 224, down to 14, and three of those are from the same league.
Right.
Midwest Athletic Conference. That is amazing.
Pretty unbelievable.
Yeah. And these guys have some unbelievable numbers, too. You know, now Coldwater, they're third all-time in state playoff victories, you know. And Marion Local, they're sneaking up on some records, too. They're not quite there, but, you know, number of state championships, they got 7. St. Ignatius has 11. 4 in a row if they get this one. St. Ignatius has 5. You know, so they got 36 games in a row. Delphi St. John's right down the road at 57, you know, without a loss, so. Or wins without a loss, it's another team that has 58. But yeah, they are dominant in the state, and they're going to go play a team, Norwalk St. Paul, that has had a good run of athletes in basketball and football. It's usually the way it goes in smaller schools. But man, to put 514 total yards up against 118 in the state semi, that is a dominant game. 390 yards rushing. That's unbelievable.
Columbus Grove, a fantastic season. Oh, they knew what they were up against, but that Marion Local defense has been so stingy. They've outscored their opponents 277-14. Just allowed 14 points in the last 6 games against all playoff teams. And Joey Wernicke ran up a storm against other opponents in this game. He was held to just 27 yards on 14 carries. And it just goes to show you the caliber of defense that Tim Goodwin has on that Flyers roster.
And congratulations to Grove. You know, they finished 9-5. Great year for Andy Schaefer and his crew. I mean, they've revitalized football up in Grove.
Very exciting.
And they're going to be fired up. They got some young players coming back next year, too. They're looking to continue that dominance and win a Northwest Conference title and the whole thing. But Marion Local, you got to give them credit. And, you know, I've heard a lot of people say, oh, they'll win this one easy. Well, nothing's easy in the state championship. But a lot of people have also said they could win about any division.
That's what I was just going to say. When you hear or see the quotes that come from the other coaches after playing against Marion Local, it's all you hear is, well, they're really good. And they mean that. And then you'll see they talk about who else they think they can beat. It's really an interesting situation for one of the best teams in the state to be in the smallest division. And they'll go up against Norwalk St. Paul, 10 a.m. Saturday at the Shoe. And like we said, they've been there before, but first time at the Shoe. That's exciting, and I think that's a motivating factor for these guys. And we'll see how it plays out as they go for win number 37 in a row.
We hope the MAC comes back with 3 state titles.
It could happen. That would be very exciting.
Sure
we
could.
Knew the MAC was great going into the season, and they're trying to prove it in week 15. Well, it's time for a break here on Mark's Madness. When we come back, we're going to change directions and hit the hardwood, talk a little hoops with Mark Schein. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back to Mark's Madness, and we've got a new Mark here seated to my left. It's Mark Schein, and that means it's time to talk basketball. Mark will be joining us throughout the basketball season here on Mark's Madness, and he's always well-prepared. He's always ready to go, and we're looking forward to this weekend tips off with the boys. But before we get into the big storylines and some of the teams that we're going to focus on here early, let's talk about some rule changes. There is one major rule change that we should be aware of headed into this season.
Yeah, that's right, Matt. The big rule change this year will be kind of like we did several years ago. There are 6 legal players allowed to line up along the free throw line, 4 defensive, 2 offense. They may now leave to rebound the basketball when the ball leaves the shooter's hands. Everybody else has to wait until the ball hits the rim. What you're going to see now is you're going to see some games. We used to have a lot of games we used to play, cross pick across the lane, up pick and so on. You're going to see some coaches now put games in and try to free up offensive rebounders on the free throw lane.
And that's something that we saw in the NBA, that we do see in the NBA, right? As soon as the ball leaves the hand, everyone's allowed in the lane.
Everybody's allowed in the lane. Those six players who are along the lane now, we used to have eight along the lane. That opened up all kinds of different games. I think you're going to see some cross picks, which will allow somebody to break free to try to get an offensive rebound. And how will the defensive teams respond to that?
Definitely something to watch going forward, especially on the free throw line.
Yep.
And in a similar vein, looking ahead a little bit to sectional and district tournaments, we're a little ways away, but there are some changes in the format this year, and what can we expect there?
Well, the Northwest District Athletic Board is still trying to finalize their plans, but apparently what they're going to do is they're going to take district sites, what they call district site seating, and they're going to take all the teams that used to be in two sectionals that would feed into a district and combine them for seating purposes. So in other words, if you had two 7-team sectionals, you'll now have one 14-team district, and you will seat everybody 1 through 14, and then number one seed gets to choose which site they want to play at, as well as which line and bracket they want to play on. Number two seed will have to go to the other site and choose a line, and everybody else 3 through 14 will get to pick a spot and a site.
Okay, very interesting. We'll obviously deal with that a little more as it approaches, but that's good to know now. And another interesting point is that there will be neutral sites for all of those games,
yes,
correct?
Yes, you know, we've started doing some places now where we have the home team gets to have a home game in some of those tournament games, like in volleyball and soccer and baseball and softball.
Right.
They still will be played at neutral sites. We're going to get away from things like we used to call the Western Buckeye League tournament, where everybody down at Lima Senior was a Western Buckeye League school. We're going to get away from those types of things by combining the two sectionals together into one giant district.
All right, great. Good. Looking forward to that. But now let's get into some of our intriguing storylines, things we're watching here as we get into the season. And let's start with the defending state champs, Lima Central Catholic T-Birds. What can we expect from the T-Birds in 2014-15 season?
Well, Matt, some people think right away the Thunderbirds are going to be down a little bit. You know, they graduated Martise Kimbrough, now at the University of Indianapolis. They lost Xavier Simpson, now down at Lima Senior. But this will be a good basketball team at Lima Central Catholic. They have some key players returning, Trey Cobbs, Jake Williams, so on. The two O'Connors are back. And I think they have a lot of hungry guys who want to say, you know what, we lost some guys from a year ago, and we want to prove that we can play anyway without those people. I think LCC will be very, very good this year. They're certainly going to be the favorites this weekend at the Tip-Off Classic.
And they're well coached, Frank Kill.
Yeah, absolutely. And Frank can dance.
Oh,
I
didn't
know that.
We won
that dance competition, too. So, you know, when you win a Dancing with the Stars dance competition and you can coach basketball.
I was not aware of that.
How versatile can you get? Congratulations,
yeah,
coach.
Great job, Coach Kill. Yeah. And we should have seen some of those moves after the state championship.
Oh, that would have been great. Yeah, we should have highlighted
I know
that
when he was on the Throwback 44 games, his guys were giving him a hard time because, you know, they had the shorter shorts. And he played at Lincoln View.
He did.
So
he had a great team at Lincoln View. Yeah.
You can be sure to look out for those Throwback 44 games. Mark Kuntz will be bringing those back shortly. Always a lot of fun to check that
great
out.
Monday nights. Yeah, those were super last year.
So moving from another team in Lima, moving to another team in Lima now, the Lima Senior Spartans, and a new look there, new coach, and the big transfer with Xavier joining Lima Senior.
Well, that's the whole key. How quick can Coach Simpson get it all put together? Obviously, they have some returning players in Stafford and Flowers and Thompson, a few guys like that. Thomas, a few guys like that. But then you bring in Xavier Simpson. You bring in four new players into the program. So you've got new players coming into the program, three of whom will be eligible immediately, one who becomes eligible in January. So you've got four new players to the program. You've got a new coach. He has to understand his players, what they can do, mesh the whole thing together, and then understand the competition they're going to play against. The Spartans will be very good at some point. The question is when.
It's going to be one of the biggest storylines going into the season, and we'll get a good look at them early on. You can see them take on Wapakoneta on next Wednesday night on WOSN. Let's go south now, Versailles, and the big storyline there is the Michigan State recruit, and he signed his letter of intent earlier this year. Kyle Arns, he's returning from injury.
I've heard some good things about Kyle. I heard he got his explosiveness back, and I've also heard some things that he had a little bit of soreness once practice started. So we're going to have to kind of wait and sort that out. He had a broken ankle last year that kind of, you know, wrecked a great season they were having going on. They kind of survived for a little while just on pure emotion, but then that kind of got away from them, and they struggled without Kyle down the stretch. But they've got good players returning around him. They are probably the favorite, particularly if he is fully healthy in the MAC.
When a high school player throws down a dunk, and Kyle is one of the few kids in the area who can dunk, it's such a momentum-shifting moment, and we're looking forward to seeing plays like that from him.
Yes, we are. We've done this many, many times on this show before your entry in here.
When Chris was here.
Quit working on the dunk and start shooting the three and making free throws.
Mr. Fundamentals. I'm Mr. Excitement. I got to see him throw it down.
I want to see that kid make three-pointers and free throws when it counts. That's what I want to see.
He'll do plenty of that as well. But he'll also throw in a dunk for us, for me and the fans that enjoy that as well. All right, let's finish out with another defending state champ, the Crestview Knights. And they had a great senior class last year that helped lead them to that state title. What can we expect out of them this year?
Well, obviously they graduated a lot of very talented players. They've got good players coming back. They've got a very, very solid coach in Coach Best, who really coaches the defensive end of the floor. And when you can defend, you're really going to be good. And they have the ability to do that. Spencerville's the other top team with returning players. They've got a lot of guys back in Spencerville. In fact, the entire Northwest Conference, the juniors are outstanding in the Northwest Conference. So it'll be a very good league. I would think Crestview and probably Spencerville at the top. We've got a game late in the season, Crestview and Wayne Trace. Wayne Trace is just dominating people in their scrimmages. That's going to be a huge matchup in February.
Wayne Trace, always good on the hardwood, and they're always fast, up and down the floor, those
they
Raiders.
They get up and down. They press very well. They run very well. There's a couple guys named Linder and a coach named Linder who are
Linder,
very talented. Yep. And they've got a lot of good players around them, and that will be a great matchup to do when we get to the February part of the schedule.
So it's going to be a lot of fun to watch all that play out, and we're just getting started. We've got a jam-packed schedule. We've got 10 games. I'm going to run through them for you. You'll be at the Elida tip-off, and you can see that at 10 p.m. on 10:44, excuse me, on WTLW on Friday night. That would be Bath versus LCC, and then immediately following that will be Shawnee versus Elida. Then Saturday, we got like five games in a row. We'll start with St. Henry versus Spencerville at 6 p.m. on WOSN. Then the Van Wert tip-off, Crestview versus Lincoln View at 7:30, followed by Van Wert versus Wayne Trace at 9. Saturday at 10:30 on WOSN, Temple versus Continental. That's another game you'll have.
Get through that game.
So Mark Shine will be all over the
Patrick
place.
Chandler.
We're not done yet, though. Then Saturday, 10:30 after the sports report on WTLW, we've got the Elida tip-off consolation game, immediately followed by the championship game. Those teams obviously to be determined by what happens on Friday. Sunday at 7:30 on the West Ohio Sports Network, it's the Van Wert tip-off consolation game. Sunday at 9, the Van Wert tip-off championship game. So it's a lot of basketball, and we're diving right in. 10 games for you. It's going to be a lot of fun. So looking forward to the basketball season with you, Mark. Thanks for joining us here, and that's going to do it for this crossover edition of Mark's Madness. We'll see you next time on the West Ohio Sports Network.